Everybody, my name is David Pegler. I'm a currency coach here at FX Bootcamp. This is your pre-London review from last evening. I'd like to cover a euro trade that we've done, but I'm going to give you some background information here first. Please remember that the purpose of FX Bootcamp is education. We're not an alert service. Always remember that trading is very risky business, and don't trade real money until you have a proven track record of success on a demo account. Anyway, here we go. This is what we looked at going into pre-London yesterday. This is an oil chart in front of you right now. And if I zoom out slightly, remember your oil correlation with the US dollar lately, and that oil heading up generally means USD weakness, i.e. the Euro USD will head up. Alternatively, oil heading down, i.e. oil devaluing in its currency, and that would mean that the Euro USD would be heading down, i.e. US dollar strength. Okay, so what I like to do a lot of times during my pre-London analysis is take a look at oil and just see how it's and see how oil's situated, not only from a opportunity from a trading perspective, but also to see if oil has permission to head up or down, and how that's obviously going to affect the US dollar from a correlatory standpoint. Okay, well, it was very evident yesterday when we walked into pre-London that, you know, oil had its problems. Okay, we were clearly at this hourly trend line, and it was in retracement mode, and we were bouncing off this trend line until that broke. You know, oil really wasn't going anywhere to the downside. So the Euro USD had every permission in that regard, that if oil wasn't really going to affect it much to the downside, that Euro had permission to head up if it needed to technically. Okay, also I was looking at the top of this, and 1589 has obviously been a pretty good resistance area. You can see how it broke and was retested as support, and going back further it was resistance. Okay, so oil effectively was stymied for the day. And that was somewhat good news for us as currency traders. Okay, we could trade the euro purely on its own merits. Additionally, when we walked into London, or pre-London I should say, we noticed that the Asian traders had a good time trading this to the downside. Now Friday we saw a lot of selling pressure in the euro. I expand this chart again, a lot of selling pressure in the euro, pound, and all the USD pairs for that matter, and that was just simply continued on what is my Sunday evening on the West Coast. And you know, as the market opened Sunday, they continued that selling in the direction of the prevailing trend. Well, as a result, we walked into the pre-London session and the euro had effectively completed its range for the day, or completed its, you know, conservative, it had reached conservative downside targets. All right, and in that case, it was the M1 reversal pivot point. Now, just a little bit of pivot theory. Anytime that you have a major session opening, now I'm well aware that the UK had a banker's holiday yesterday, and we didn't see that immediate injection of money that we typically see around midnight Pacific, but we were still going to see an increase of money flowing into the market as the European market opened, and we needed to trade that accordingly. Now, typically, any time that you walk into a London that has us starting at the M1 reversal pivot point, yes, believe it or not, we reverse from there, and it simply boils down to a buy low, sell high mentality. Okay, nothing more complex than that. You simply want to buy at the bottom and sell at the top. So then it was just a matter of trying to work out how that was going to happen. Okay, and if I expand this euro chart, now I'm the first one to say that I do not like to trade a reversal, but if that's what the market presents us, then we got to go into that frame of mind that, hey, we're going to be trading a reversal. It's never as smooth a move, because you always have wood to chop, so to speak. All the upside, all the downside support that you created on the way down in terms of dynamic support in the way of EMAs, etc., are now going to become dynamic resistance on the way up. Okay, you're going to have to break all these quick moving 21 EMAs. you're gonna have to break all these quick moving 5 EMAs on longer term time frames. So you're always gonna have things in your way, and it's likely to be a fairly painful exercise in terms of your trade management. Okay, so it really is a case of find a good entry and let it do its thing, because you know through your trade planning that it's gonna be a choppy exercise and you just need to trade it accordingly. Anyway, getting down to the nitty gritty here. We had drawn up 46.96 as being support for euro. Okay, as I opened the room, we saw that the Bollinger Band was close to price, therefore there was no implied volatility to the downside. Okay, so what happens, euro comes down and hits that 46.96 very clearly and is soundly rejected off that level. Okay, that created a long opportunity just given what the Bollinger Band was doing, but I don't think that anyone in the room actually claimed that long. We were opening the room and, you know, frankly, it was just a continuation of what we were already seeing, and we were still trying to gather our bearings in terms of the pre-London session. All right, but what we did notice and take into account was the fact that we had some pretty serious stochastic divergence, okay, and if I just expand this MACD here really quickly, we also were getting what was now a second MACD cross to the upside. Okay, you can see we crossed down a little bit. And anytime you cross down on a major oscillator like this and go almost nowhere, the subsequent cross to the upside is significant. And at the same time, we were getting MACD divergence, bullish MACD divergence, with a second MACD cross to the upside just after us hitting this major support area. Okay, so we were getting some clues that, hey, this puppy might want to go up for the day. All right, and then it just was a matter of trading it from there. If you looked over at its comrade Swissy over here, the Swissy was showing even more signs of clear double top, all right, with stochastic divergence itself. And anytime you have a double top, stochastic divergence, and a 5A cross at a major European Open, you can bet your bottom dollar that you're going to be looking to trade that to the downside, okay? How was this tradable? We knew that the 90 area was going to be tough. Well, it was just simply a matter of drawing a fib from the low to the high. Perfect 382 overlap with the 21 EMA pushing down on price along with the 8. You watch your short-term one-minute confirmation for that, and you had yourself a beautiful little trade to the downside. So Swissy was really our proxy for what the euro wanted to do. Euro was a little more convoluted in its direction than what the Swissy was, but that double top was noticeable to all and sundry, including the pound setup that was discussed by Christian Stevens in his London video. You know, we had, from a correlatory standpoint, we had everything setting up. From an oil standpoint, we didn't have anything hurting us. And in the case of the euro, how we actually inserted ourselves into this move was we knew the 21 was going to have its time in the sun before it broke. So it was just a matter of letting price go up, hitting dynamic resistance, and then coming down to logical fib before continuation. So this is how we traded it. Okay, we let price bounce, we let it head up, come down off some resistance, okay, and then we referred to 1 minute chart and pulled up what we called a reverse fib. Now, it's a reverse fib because typically we're pointing our fibs to the downside in anticipation of continuation. Well, today we were actually physically trading for a reversal, so we pointed our fibs to the upside, okay, i.e. counter trend reversal, okay, and we let the 21 do its job. It pulled back to a logical fib area, and I like to call the 382 to 50% the ideal trade zone for a bounce point, okay? And you either took it right off the 50% fib, alternatively you waited for a 1 minute stochastic cross, and that's what I did. So my entry was 47.19 on this pair to the upside, just based on a 1 minute fib and stochastic cross in the direction of our bias, in the direction of what the USD correlation was. And you could very easily insert yourself into this move. And if you waited long enough, you could have got a 1 minute MACD cross off the fib as well. And then you know, the rest is history for the day. Where was the profit target? You know, pivot theory says that if you start the day at M1, you should be looking for M2, I'm sorry, M3, and that overlapped with the hourly 200. Unfortunately, we didn't quite make it up there. We hit the central pivot point and we were rejected for the day. But by the time you know, you got a little 1-2-3 pattern at the top, you're a little lower high. And the bare minimum, though, that you should have gleaned on this trade was about 60 to 65 pips. And if you were agile, you could have got out with slightly more than that. But a really good, well thought out setup that we were able to make at least minimal acceptable performance. And if you add to that the pound trades, the Swissie trades, and you know, the Australian dollar and Kiwi plays, you know, all in all, a pretty good Monday. Anyway, that wraps up your pre-London review. I hope that you got something out of this video, and I hope to see you in class sometime. Take it easy.